legislators up here, House and Senate, and people like Alan Benz, that didn't happen, because we all knew the consequences of having to deal with Alan, if we would let that happen. So we put the $300 million in Triumph, and now they're gonna go to work and see what they can do to help this region of the state. And you know, George Gaynor had an important role in that. I got so tired of hearing from George about that issue, but we got him. And now the rest is history. The rest is up to the board of how they take that money and put it to work for this region. The Port of Panama City did very well in this legislative session. You have an opportunity, I think, a game changer. The contract that Eastern Shipbuilding has for the Coast Guard boats is a game changer for this entire region, not just Bay County or Panama City, but for all the counties around here, because all those counties have welders in them and have people that need jobs, and this is a great opportunity to take this region the next step. But to do it, we had to, you know, get some help for that port and the dredging of the port and some of the facilities that are required in, you know, when you do a contract with the Defense Department. They've got, I forget, Brian told me, 50 or 100 their people that come down here and need to house them, and, you know, in an office and so forth. And we're going to, we provided $9.5 million to get that off the ground to help that. Now, I will tell you that I hear rumors that the Florida Ports Council is trying to cop that money away from Panama City, trying to get the Port of Panama City to run that through their system, as opposed to taking it as a direct appropriation, which is what it was intended by the legislature. And if that were to happen, it would be a really bad day, because the port council would regret it, as well as the port. The legislature said where it needs to go spent, and if we're not going to spend it that way, then probably never ask for anything again. So I'm going to make sure that that money gets spent here in Panama City. And as Alan said, you know, I do have sort of a reputation of not wanting to get on the wrong side. The other area that I know is important for this region is your beaches. And this year, President Negron and I made beaches a priority. The beach renourishment program, which you know, we shouldn't have to renourish beaches. I guess if we had left them alone 50 years ago and hadn't built on them or whatever, let them do the way God intended, we wouldn't need them, but we didn't, so we have to. And we have to keep putting sand on some of the beaches, because we have 114 million tourists that come to Florida every year, and one of the biggest reason they come to Florida is our beaches. And so we need to continue that program, and this year we doubled the amount of money coming from the state to be used for beach renourishment. And I think that's going to be an important part of the future of this region. The bad. Well, we all had some personal encounters with the bad, and that was when the governor came over here, because the governor and the House were fighting about our economic development programs. Wasn't just the governor and the House, it was the governor and the House, or the governor and the Senate versus the House, because Senate supported the governor. The original bill that the House Speaker came up with before session would have completely dismantled our economic development programs in Florida. Would have done away with Enterprise Florida. Enterprise Florida is the business-private partnership that we put into place and when Republicans took control of the legislature back in the 90s. Prior to that, our economic development had been done by a bunch of state bureaucrats in the state building in Tallahassee. And what do they know about how to communicate with business executives in other states? So we made it a business public-private partnership, with the state having a role and private business having a role. And this year, there was actually a bill filed that would have eliminated that agency. I don't know what we would have done about economic development if we didn't have that agency. That bill would have also eliminated Visit Florida. And I know I don't have to tell you how important Visit Florida is to this region and the tourism that we bring. For years, Florida had tourists. For years, we had 70 to 80 million tourists a year. When Governor Scott took office and decided to make that a real priority, and we started spending money advertising, we went from 70 or 80 million a year to 114 million. That's a big difference. And that's a big economic impact. And I think what some of the people that supported that bill didn't acknowledge is the piece of our tax revenue that comes from tourists. And if we don't have that tax revenue that comes from tourists, who's gonna have to make up the difference? Us. 25% of our sales tax revenue in Florida comes from tourists. And sales tax is the bread and butter of how we finance our state budget. So, it's important to keep economic going because of economic development going because of the need to diversify our revenue so that those of us that are left don't have to pick up the whole tab ourselves. And I think they lost sight of that. We have, our governor has had a single-minded focus on jobs. And I think it's paid dividends. We've had, somewhere in the neighborhood of 1.2 million new jobs added since he took office in 2010. But what we have also, some people lose sight of the fact that there are 36 counties in Florida that have actually lost jobs since 2007 when the recession started. 36 counties. And many of those counties are right around here. All the counties to the north of here, all the counties to the east of here, a couple counties to the west of here, have lost jobs since 2007. So we still have a long way to go in economic development. And that's why projects like Eastern Shipbuilding's major league contract that they got are so important. And we need to do everything we can to support them. And that's what I try to do. Now, that was the bad, the ugly. Well, the ugly has a little bit to do with all of us in the process. House, Senate, Governor, the way it came together. As Alan said, I've been in and out of Tallahassee for a long time. This was my 15th session in the Florida Senate. This was without a doubt the session that I'm the least proud of because of the way it came together. I think a lot of why it came together the way it did was because of the effect that term limits has had on Tallahassee. I voted for term limits. Probably most of you voted for term limits. We thought it was a great idea. And what some people predicted that would happen was that it would empower lobbyists. Other people predicted that it would empower staff. What it has instead done, in my opinion, is it's empowered the presiding officers to have almost total control over both houses of legislature. And this year we saw that in the negotiation of some of the major issues, where you have one presiding officer trade to the other presiding officer their priorities. And, it's those kind of trades sound good in principle, but in practice, sometimes they don't work out quite as well because the devil is in the details. And, I never thought that we were going to have to accept some of the details of some of those bills when we agreed to trade the broad principles in those bills. Senate was committed to higher education improvements, and we got a lot of good higher education improvements. A lot more money. We returned to our original intent for Bright Future Scholarship, a really fully funded a lot more kids, like 40-something thousand more kids are going to get fully funded with Bright Future Scholarship. We substantially increased needs-based financial assistance. We substantially increased a lot of the pots of money that are used to produce quality higher education. But the House was more concerned with K through 12, specifically their quest to continue to ramp up charter schools and private schools at the expense of public schools. And unfortunately, we ended up with a bill that was like the combination of 30-something other bills, was brought out at the last minute. People didn't have an opportunity to vote on it. And if we hadn't have accepted that bill, the whole session would have collapsed and we wouldn't have gotten done. So I, along with a lot of other people, went along with it. And at the time, I thought that the war between the governor and the House would result in the governor vetoing the bill. And yes, you shouldn't make decisions based on what you think somebody else is going to do. I should have made the decision based on the case at hand. But it was kind of an ugly end. There's some pieces of that bill that I think can get fixed. For the first time, we allowed the capital outlay dollars for the public schools to be spent on charter schools. The Senate version of it had some protections in there on getting those assets returned if the school went out of business, and providing some arm's length kind of controls. I'm not sure if those ended up in the final bill, but if they didn't, we're going to work on that again next year. And there's some pieces of that bill that will get worked on again and get changed. But one thing it has shown me is that we can't do business like that. And you know, I'm in the role that I have for one more year as the appropriations chairman. I do have a lot of control over what gets done in the appropriation conference and what gets included in those so-called conforming bills. And we're not going to have any of those next year. So you know, we had a tough year, but hopefully everyone has learned by that, and hopefully we'll do a better job with it. With that, I think we covered the good, the bad, and the ugly. Now I'd be happy to answer some questions.
That question.